بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على محمد وآله الطاهرين. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. أولم يروا إلى الطير فوقهم صافات ويقبضن ما يمسكهن إلا الرحمن إنه بكل شيء بصير. Have they not regarded the birds above them, spreading and closing their wings? No one sustains them except the All-Beneficent. Indeed, He sees best all things. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives everything its guidance. Musa alayhi salam, when he went to see the Pharaoh, according to the Quran, the Pharaoh asked him, "And who is your God?" He replied, along with his brother Harun, that our God, our Lord, is the one who created everything and gave it guidance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides the sun as what to do. The earth, with its rotation around itself, the rotation around the sun, with its distance from the moon, the planets, gravity, etc., etc. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, al-muhaymin, means the one who's in charge of everything. Al-qayyum, He oversees everything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not create this universe and just leave it up to the laws that He created. As the mufawwidha claim, the mufawwidha, a group of individuals who claim that Allah created this world, created the laws, and then that's it. He is no longer than overseeing. He just made the laws and that's it. It's like self-running itself. And that's wrong. This is not what we believe in. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in charge of everything. So Allah is giving us an example. Look at the birds. Some birds fly without flipping their wings too much. You know, for example, eagles, owls. And there are the birds that flip and they flick their wings quite a lot to fly. So, in fact, this is interestingly a fiqhi perspective. The birds that do not flip their wings too much when they fly, they just like, you know, mostly keep up like this, we're not allowed to eat those birds. But that's a fiqhi issue. So Allah has given us this example. These birds, when they fly, who actually controls them? Who can bring them down? Who can take that ability of flying away from them? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can. And He is بكل شيء بصير. He is seeing, all seeing of everything. He knows everything. He sees everything. Imam Al-Ridha alayhi salam says he sees, but without the eyes like we do. He sees everything. He is basir even before having a creation being created. He can see. He is all-seeing. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also something important in this ayah is Ar-Rahman. مَا يُمْسِكُهُنَّ إِلَّا الرَّحْمَنِ. None other than the Beneficent will sustain them, would take the power away from them. We mentioned in the very first episode when we talked about Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim that ar-Rahman is an attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The mercy of Allah that encompasses all His servants. Al-Shaykh al-Saduq, Radwanullah ta'ala alayhi, in his book At-Tawheed has a section, number 29, designated for the meanings of the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where he lists them and he describes them. After hadith number 9, he, may Allah bless his soul, lists all the attributes, the 99 attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and gives their meaning. Just as a side note, I mentioned also in a previous episode in the series that while there are 99 main attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Dua al-Jawshan al-Kabir contains 100 sections. Every section contains 10 attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they're like 1,000 attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nonetheless, when he comes to Ar-Rahman, Al-Shaykh Al-Saduq says, its meaning is the one whose mercy has encompassed everything of his creation, through sustaining them, through giving them guidance, everything. And that's why if you read Surah Ar-Rahman, Surah Ar-Rahman, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks of the sun, speaks of the moon, speaks of the stars. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Ar-Rahman, allama al-Qur'an, khalaqa al-insan, allamahu al-bayan, al-shamsu wal-qamaru bi-husban, wal-najmu wal-shajaru yasjudan, wal-samaa rafa'aha wa wada'a al-mizan, and so on and so forth. His mercy encompassed all his creation. Everything that Allah has created, Allah has given it some guidance, and that is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to all his creation. The birds know exactly what to eat, how to find their food, how to train for flying, for example, the younger ones. The animals, subhanallah, the bees, if you take a look, there is a surah in the Quran called Surah the Bees, Surah the Ants, the ant kingdom, the bee kingdom, how they live amongst each other. And by kingdom, of course, I don't mean that in the animal kingdom, you know, that sense. No, but I mean as a group, how they live, how organized they are, how can get the honey, prepare it, and so on and so forth. Subhanallah. All these are signs for those who reflect. And Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam has a beautiful sermon in Nahjul Balagha about the ant. How small it is. You can't even tell where the parts of it. Yet Allah designed it all. Allah guided it as how to get its food, and so on and so forth. So Ar-Rahman is the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it is associated with Allah. In the sense, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also says in Surah Al-Isra, verse 110, قُلْ اِدْعُوا اللَّهَ أَوْ اِدْعُوا الرَّحْمَانَ أَيَّمَّا تَدْعُوا فَلَهُ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى. Say, invoke Allah or invoke the All-Beneficent. Whichever of his names you may invoke, to him belong the best names. اُدْعُوا اللَّهَ أَوْ اِدْعُوا الرَّحْمَانَ. Therefore, some of the ulama, they say Ar-Rahman is a name that is exclusive to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, specific to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the meaning of it encompasses all his creation. A person cannot name himself Ar-Rahman, according to some scholars, because that's the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, exclusive. That's an attribute exclusive to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes, you can name Abdul Rahman, like you can name Abdullah. Whereas Rahim, merciful, which is that mercy which is exclusive to the believers. That's an exclusive mercy, but the attribute is general. You have many people who can be called Rahim or attributed Rahim. He's merciful. He's kind. So Rahim, the meaning of it is exclusive to the believers when it's attributed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the attribute can be distributed to any person who displays acts of mercy, Rahim, merciful. Whereas Ar-Rahman is exclusive to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but the meaning of it is general. The mercy is to all his creation, even the kafir, the disbelievers, those who associate with Allah, those who reject Allah. Allah still gives them rizq, sustenance, gives them food, health. So the Rahmaniyyah, the all-beneficent mercy of Allah, encompasses them as well. So these are important lessons to learn, my brothers and sisters, and of the Rahmaniyyah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of his mercy that encompasses all his servant, that he sends prophets and he sends imams. That's part of his rahmah. Also part of his lutf. Allah is latif. Latif. Lutf, latif, is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all attentive to his servants. He attends every detail. So out of his attention to the servants, he knows that they need a guide. They need someone to guide them. So the aql is there that can deduce them to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But how do I know how to pray? For example, 5 times a day, fast the month of Ramadan, fast from dawn till, for example, after sunset, you know, when the sun has completely gone down, and so on and so forth. All these rules, all these obligations, where do I get them from? From the wahi, from the revelation. So Allah, out of His lutf, sent us the prophets and the imams, alayhim as-salam. And therefore, it is important for us to follow them. Those who only follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they have a sunnah of 23 years, whereas those who follow the imams, there is a sunnah of the Prophet, 23 years, plus an additional 250 years approximately until the time of Ghaybatul Sughra of the imam. The imam went into Ghaybatul Sughra in the year 260 after Hijra. The Prophet died in the year 11 after Hijra. That's almost 250 years more of sunnah that the followers of Ahlul Bayt have, wealth of knowledge that they have. And if you add Al-Ghaybatul Sughra, that's an additional 69, 70 years to the 250 years of knowledge, of wisdom, of guidance that Ahlul Bayt provided to the people. Interestingly, Husham ibn al-Hakam, one of the companions of Al-Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam and Al-Imam al-Kadhim, he was a great man. He was invited one day by Yahya ibn Khalid al-Barmaki. And Yahya told him, I would like you to have a discussion with Dhirar ibn Dhamrah al-Dhabi about imamah. Ahlul Bayt trained their followers to defend imamah. In fact, it is safe to say that imamah is the first root of religion that was disputed after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Because people disputed whether Ali should be the Khalifa or someone else. So that was the first thing. Abu Dhar al-Ghafari, Ridwanullah ta'ala alayh, Salman al-Farisi, Ridwanullah ta'ala alayh, Miqdad, Ammar. These people defended imamah. They disputed imamah. That was the first thing that Muslims disputed. They did not dispute tawheed. Or dispute, for example, ma'ad, or nubuwah, or adalah. At that time, it was not the issue. The issue was imamah. And the first book written by the followers of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam, Sulaym ibn Qais, was to discuss imamah. And the first, and there is the book, is with us still, it's there, although some people dispute, is this really the same book as Kitab Sulaym ibn Qais, the original one of the companions of Imam Ali alayhi as-salam, or is this a different one? That's besides the point. The book that we definitely know, it survived, and it is among the people who lived at the time of Imam al-Hadi and al-Askari alayhim as-salam, As-Saffar. As-Saffar, his book Basair al-Darajat, that book is only about imamah. The book of imamah, imamah, the Shia, the followers of Ahlul Bayt, really defended imamah. Because once you recognize the imam, then you recognize Rasulullah. And then you recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why we read in the dua, O Allah, make me recognize you. For if I don't recognize you, I would not recognize your messenger. O Allah, make me recognize your messenger. For if I don't recognize your messenger, I would not recognize your proof, your hujjah. O Allah, make me recognize your proof. For if I don't recognize your proof, I would be misguided from my religion. So Husham ibn al-Hakam was brought by Yahya ibn Khalid al-Barmaki, who was one of the ministers of Harun al-Rashid, to have a discussion with Dhirar ibn Dhamra al-Dhabi about imamah. So Husham said, no problem. He came to Dhirar and he asked him a question. He said, Ya Aba Amr, O father of Amr, أخبرني على ما تجب الولاية والبراءة أعلى الظاهر أم على الباطن. On what basis do you claim association, ولاية, with someone or disassociate with someone, yourself from someone? Is it on the ظاهر, what they do outside, or what's hidden in their heart, their faith, their deep faith in the heart? Like when you act, do you act on the basis of the outside, what you see, or what's inside? Dhirar said, La ala dhahir. No, it's on the what's on the outside, what I see them doing, their actions. Because al-batin, the inside, what's in their heart, لا يدركوا إلا بالوحي. It does not be proved except through revelation. How do I know what's in your heart or in people's heart? When I see someone praying, for example, I see him praying, خلاص, he has a sign of a mu'min, even when it comes to adala. In Islam, there are certain things where you require the testimony of a adil shahid, a witness who is fair, just. Justice, it is said, by the actions, the general actions we see. We don't know what's in that. I see someone praying, fasting, appears to be a good mu'min. Inshallah, he has the adala. What's in his heart? Who is he praying to please? What is he praying for? Who is he fasting for? What is the reason? That's between him and Allah that I cannot see. I don't see what's in the heart. So Dirar said to Hisham ibn al-Hakam, we act on the actions. And that's the actions that we observe. We see the hidden meaning or the hidden faith, what's in the heart, that's hidden and that's not observable, except through revelation. Hisham said, Ahsant, good job. So tell me, which of those two was more in line of defending Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alih, sacrificing for him with the sword and defeating his enemies in more than one occasion and in the jihad, fighting in the battles, Ali ibn Abi Talib or Abu Bakr? So Dirar replied, he said, no, Ali ibn Abi Talib. But Abu Bakr had more certainty. ولكن أبا بكر أشد يقينا. Hisham then replied, he said, but that's the inside. How do you know he had more yaqeen? You just said that we can't judge on the basis of what's hidden. We judge on the actions. So therefore, your claim is invalid. If you judge on the actions, Ali ibn Abi Talib deserves to have the wilayah. He said, you have just testified to Ali that on the actions, on the basis of his actions, he is the one more deserving of the wilayah. He says, even then, what if we add the hidden as well? He said, how? Hisham told him, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi told Imam Ali, you are to me like Harun is to Musa, except that there's no prophet after me. Are you aware of this hadith? Do you approve of it? He said, yes, the Prophet said it. And it's also narrated by Sahih al-Bukhari, by the way, this hadith. So Dirar said, yes, I accept this hadith. It's true. So Hisham then gave it to him. He said, أَفَيَجُوزْ أَنْ يَقُولْ هَذَا الْقَوْلِ إِلَّا وَعِنْدَهُ فِي الْبَاطِنِ مُؤْمِنِ He says, is it possible for the Prophet to say something like this unless he knows for sure that Ali, salamullahi alayhi, in his heart is a true believer? Otherwise, how can he tell him you're to me like Harun is to Musa? Harun was the associate of Musa in the message. وَأَشْرِكْهُ فِي أَمْرِي in Surah Taha. Prophet Musa prays, Ya Allah, make him my associate in this command, in the command of Nubuwwah. He was the associate of the Prophet, except Imam Ali is not a prophet. So the Prophet ﷺ definitely knew that Ali ibn Abi Talib was a mu'min, God-fearing in his heart. It is exactly what's in his action, demonstrated in his action. He has certainty, he has yaqeen. Do you not agree with this? Dirar said, yes. He said, then you have just confessed that Imam Ali alayhi salam, on the basis of his actions and on the basis of his hidden faith, he deserves the walayah. Whereas your companion, you did not prove either one of them. Assalamu alayka ya Amir al-Mu'mineen. On the 20th of the month of Ramadan, he is in pain of the poison and the strike of Abdurrahman ibn Muljam. Yet, despite this, he tells Imam al-Hasan, make sure you feed Abdurrahman ibn Muljam the same food you give me. So despite his pain, he tells Imam al-Hasan, look after my murderer. Amir al-Mu'mineen, with his love to humanity, with his care, cares even for his murderer and worries about him eating well. I say, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, we love you. We care for you. Inshallah, we are amongst your Shia. So care for us as well. In dunya, in the qabr, and in the akhirah. Wassalamu alayka ya Amir al-Mu'mineen. Wa ya Sayyid al-Wasiyyin. Wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.